show the statistics.
That's right.
No, you don't have the statistics of bubbles on the radio.
The summary, is that it? Yeah, let me see.
Number of bubbles, you said.
Oh.
Yeah. And the number of regions. And there is a...
This one?
Yes, yes. You observed the 173 anomalous gradients.
Yes.
And just 44 bubbles.
Yeah. Well, so we were observing them from different ground stations. So we saw the gradient. We might have seen the same bubble from two or three ground stations. Mm-hmm. So that's why that count, that's why this count is more than this count. Mm-hmm. And it was because we were counting a gradient if we saw it from one ground station or from another ground station at a similar time. And then we concluded after we had analyzed the actual bubble itself that it was the same bubble causing gradients at two different ground stations. So that's why that's not that. Yeah, yeah.
Thank
I realize that does look a little funny, but that's what we were doing.
Okay, thank you.
But right or wrong, that's what we were doing.
Yes. Can you go back to that first map with my natural storages? I think I want to go back to an ongoing discussion. May I?
Oh,
you see here?
Oh, yes.
This is the result from a magnetic storm.
Yes.
And you have a fast transition from blue to deep red.
Yes, oh yeah.
And this will move across USA.
Yes.
Okay. Can you move forward, please? More. 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 More dead. And then I understand in that context the model.
Yes.
On the other hand, this is a kind of a plasma bubble, which is, I think, is a different thing. I can show you in situ measurements from the plasma bubble. I can project that.
Oh, I'm sorry, I went away.
The green curve.
Let me get it back. I'm sorry.
And in summary, I have some difficulty into fitting that model into the plasma bubble. You see how simple that is in comparison with the plasma bubble model. You have a single gradient.
Yes.
While here you have very fast and gradients all over. And do you think a model that was developed for magnetic storms effects going moving across the USA would be valid in an environment where you have bubbles like that? This is an open
question. Yeah, it's a good question, and I can't
for
answer it.
All of us.
Yeah.
This is something that I started last time when I came for the initial presentation.
Yes. The answer is yes.
The answer is?
They made a model based on this formula.
Yeah. So, you think this model is valid for very plausible?
It's not valid. Okay. This model, no. It's not valid.
It's
let's say, in this model, if...
This is a in situ measurements of a plasma bubble. You see how they are, the green curve and the blue curve. I can project that if you want.
Right. Yeah. So again, it's a good discussion, and I wish I had more background to give you a better answer. All I can say is this was how we characterized it. And you'll notice the data in Singapore are not this severe. So again, this was...
I don't remember where this is from, or where the satellite was when I selected this.
Yeah.
It could very well be in over South America.
Yeah.
And on top of that, this is a smooth version, because you have irregularities. This satellite is sampling at 512 Hertz.
I'm sure this is smooth.
The blue curve is the standard deviation of the irregularity fluctuations.
It's irregular, okay.
So plasma bulb is something like this. So when I look at this model, what is this?
It is a simpler model than you're developing here. So, but these were not generally storm events. They were after sunset bubble type events.
Yeah.
And this is how we characterize them in general.
Can you move forward a little bit?
Sure.
A little bit.
Here, let me give you this before I drop it.
If you wish.
Where do you want it?
Sort of this. More. One more piece. More. This. This looks like a received signal. Can you see how fast it oscillates? The green curve, for instance.
Yes. Yeah.
I have an extremely difficult time in fitting that simple gradient model into something like the green curve. That's my problem.
Okay.
This is a general question, if anybody cares for the moment.
These conus models, they assume a constant C. Am I right?
I don't know what's inside that deep red region. We don't have all we have is this.
Yeah, this
is very well known.
This is not.
This one.
This really is not. What we're at, it's probably not an appropriate picture for the presentation.
Yeah, if you put this across,
and this is a problem that you
make
have.
Plot a graph of the measurement of densities, it would probably be also very irregular.
Yeah.
It was sexy.
But what this slide is doing is just trying to introduce that the ionosphere causes difficulties for GBAS. Not necessarily talking about bubbles.
Yeah, so
of course, it used to.
My point is, I'm still uncomfortable with that gradient model, and I don't have anything to put in place.
And the Morse model was completely out in this form for many hours.
Mm-hmm.
There was
mm-hmm.
when they had the system, I believe 14 or 16 hours without the sense mm-hmm. because of this form.
Oh yeah. This causes quite a bit of problem with SMAS. We essentially lost vertical guidance over the entire United States.
I'd like to say once, GBAS is DGPS. If you think GBAS as DGPS, the model is that. But that is why I think you need to think about a new concept of GBAS. If you think GBAS as it is now,
we need to see that, that model, because it's what the concept. GBAS, you have one station here, another station here, then you have
to have an aircraft over here.
Yes, and then, but anyway, but you send the correction. The idea is simple, and that is why they use this model. Then I think for working with GPS for landing, we need to think another way of, I don't know, GBAS, maybe another name. Of course, the model, as it is, it does not work for bubbles.
Yeah.
But then we need that. It's not to change the model, we have to change the way of making GBAS. I don't know if I lost people.
Well, I have one commenter. As I told, I did part of the team which developed the strat mod to Brazil area. And we just following simple criteria, we should find gradient. And we didn't care about what happened with loss of log, root pass, caused by plasma bowl. No, you just need gradient and gradient. Today, I don't agree with this, you know. Loss of log when the signal crossed the set of the plasma bowl, it was ignored. So I don't agree with this. Okay, so maybe following the galera idea, now we must think about this and find a new...
I agree with you, but let's remember that... an unobserved error in the airplane is potentially a much more serious occurrence than loss of log. Okay, loss of lock in an airplane, I know that happens right away, and I can go around. Okay, unobserved error and an unalarmed error, I don't know. So the airplane continues the approach. So I agree with you that loss of lock is extremely important, and if you're losing lock every minute, you're not going to do anything. But from an analysis and safety viewpoint, loss of lock is a different kind of problem, and in my opinion, as a pilot, much less severe than unalarmed errors. So that, you know, that I appreciate what you're saying, but they're two different things. But I agree with you, sir. This is something that we need to do it this way.
Yeah.
We need to figure out a different way to do this, particularly, I mean, let's face it, this is all dealing with Category 1 right now. Now, Category 3 is a different thing.
Okay, let me see if I got right. So, loss of log, part of a different criteria, different...
Yeah, it's just a different...
We must include...
But just understand, at least from the operator point of view, from a pilot point of view, a loss of lock and a loss of signal, okay, I know about that. And all of our systems are designed to tell me that I've lost signal very quickly, usually in a Category 1 is 6 seconds. I believe Category 2 is 4 or 3 seconds, I don't remember. So I learned about loss of log and loss of signal very quickly, whereas I don't learn about this at all unless the system alarms me. And in the case of the bubbles and gradients, the system may not alarm me. It may not set an alarm to me. So yeah, you're quite correct. It's just a little bit different viewpoint there. Of course, availability is also, and continuity are very important, because if the system is not available, then it's no good. I can't use it. So I spend $2 million on the system and I have to keep my ILS.
Yes, this is it. But let's say about the loss of log. If it's in the aircraft, the pilot knows what to do.
Right.
But is in the base station. They see that they don't have enough satellite. They also can send it.
They have to look. Because
you don't, if there is loss of luck, you don't have the measurement. And they, let's say, there is implicitly, if you have less than 5 satellites,
yeah, right,
you can't use that. Well, I would say that, okay, to make the analysis, but in the system running, it is implicit there because the base station don't get the satellites.
I know. Okay, I agree.
So, yeah. So if it cannot, no, if it cannot meet the VAL and the HAL, then it will send an alarm. Mm-hmm. And for category one, that alarm will be received in the airplane within 6 seconds.
Okay, but so, even though I think it's very important to discuss and we
it's tremendous important, just not what we're looking at here. That's I'm sorry.
Okay, I agree. Now I understand. You know, my major is not high as both of you, but
you can bow to me. So let me just say, when I come to meetings like this, and when I go to meetings with the FAA and all, I often find that it's very handy to have my point of view, you know, because it's not that I'm smarter or less smart or whatever than other folks, it's just I have a little bit different point of view. And like I said, I consider loss of lock to be much less serious than an error that I can't see. From a pilot point of view, because I think I mentioned either yesterday or the day before, approximately for airliners in the U.S. and Europe, approximately one approach in every 1,000 does a missed approach. And that's not because of anomaly. They just do it because air traffic or some other reason. So this is a very common, it happens thousands of times a month. And okay, I'd rather land, but it's not dangerous. So, but in this case, where I've got an error that I can't see, and I'm in the clouds, I don't know what I've got there. So it's just a little different point of view. But I appreciate what you're saying, and I agree with you that loss of lock is very important. But it's a different kind of threat to me.
You know that we use the Sigala Calibra, the ISM aircraft to identify how many loss of lock we have?
Yeah, I sent it some slide for this workshop to show the symbol, the statistics about this subject, I mean loss of lock and something. But I just applied for one day, you know, very simple, and we found a lot of cases with not availability of enough number of satellites. And so, because this, I'm worried with this, of course, as I must, now I know that we must separate in different technology, okay, at different levels. But for example, for economic, if the airplane always must to, it must be analyzed because all the time when we are in plasma bubble season in Brazil, for example, all night. Terrible. So of course, it's important to know that the system has improved awareness about this and very safe for the pilot.
Not unsafe.
But you know, maybe economic.
Well, we discussed the other day about dual frequency.
Yeah.
And I think that will help this problem to some degree. But if you have a lot of loss in lock,
one interesting thing to say is that including the Sigala and Calibra project, in the Sigala project was the idea to more or less understand about what is happening, and in Calibra was the idea to try to improve one of the things to improve the receiver's quality. And Septentrio and Moraes Alison saw that after some new firmware that they developed for the receiver, the loss of lock was reduced drastically. And what we saw, okay, we continued measuring, but the measurement was not so good as the another one, but at least you had the measurement.
Okay,
And Mariana is there?
There is
Mariana. And Mariana is working, that we want to investigate all Cigala Calibra database to take some statistics, and maybe one thing that you put in the list is to analyze how many laws of lock we had at that time. I mean, how many satellites? At least we have one more full idea of that. What if
we agree here that very important.
It's absolutely important.
And all these discussions are so much aligned with Emmanuel commentary. You know, it's very interesting, and we must to discuss
because sometimes you don't have the carrier, but you have the cell branch. Could you comment on that, Philip?
Well, it has to do with the coherence.
Yeah.
The tracking loops for carrier phase, they're more sensitive.
Yes.
And sometimes the signal is just gone, and you can still get the pseudo range measurement, but you cannot get the carrier phase. We see similar in multipath. When you get the reflection off the sea surface, if the water is calm, then you can track the reflection well. But if there are strong winds, the surface is rough, and the reflection is not coherent, then you cannot track the carrier phase. So I guess the plasma has this similar scattering effect.
Because at the end, what I want to say is that sometimes we have lots of luck in the carrier, but we have the sealed branch as well. That is what we use for the DGTS.
We could use a Doppler. Doppler would be less sensitive, I think. No, I'll take that back. It would be as bad as carrier phase.
To analyze, to validate manually the result of LTIN, we always consider what you have in phase and what you have in carrier. And to check and to confirm the gradients. Because this, I agree. Sometime occurring one.
But DLL and PLL is very different.
So I think that for
may be more robust receivers.
For GBAS, the interpolated maps are not as important as for SBAS. For GBAS, you can work with the rod, with the tech itself, and derive the gradient from there, and the station separation. Since it's a very local effect, the concern for smoothing the data in GBAS, I don't think it's as severe as in SBAS.
The SBAS is.
In fact, I like the phrase. I don't know. I think Andrew Walker presented, and I don't know who created this phrase, the first sentence, but I like the plasma, no killing with plasma bubble.
No?
Plasma bubble is no killing. Plasma bubble is not
killing. Yeah. But as we. Philip said, because the DGPS or the GBAS, how can I see? Paulo said yesterday about SSR.
I was about to comment on.
Yeah, and another one is on the, because OSR. It's in the space, state space representation. You put every error there. And in GBAS is not SSR, is
OSR.
OSR, observation space representation. And as you said about the, if you have a tech map, mm-hmm. and you think it's one way to change the GBAS concept, mm-hmm. from OSR to SSR.
Yeah.
In some way could help a little bit. Any more questions?
So like I said, I will send Milton the paper of this.
Please.
And I'll give your feedback to Sam and Bakri and us to perhaps get a little dialogue going on that. So.
Great.
That
would
be good. Yeah, thank you. Like I said, I'm sorry, this isn't my area that I work in all the time, so I'm less able to answer some of the questions you had, but I appreciate the observation. I hope this was interesting. So let me say, I really appreciate coming down here and meeting with y'all and talking with y'all and interacting. It was very much fun. This is my third trip to Brazil, and I really like Brazil. Of course, it's my first trip to Presidente Prudente, but it's very interesting. And again, being with y'all has been the best part. People ask me, because I'm 71, they say, why do you still work? And I said, well, I like the work I do.
Yes.
And I work with interesting people, and I think you count there. And they still pay me, so that's okay too. And but to me, the people that I get to work with make working fun. And sometimes finishing a report at 1 a.m. in the morning is not fun. But working with the people always is, so that's good. And I appreciate it. And appreciate your hospitality to me, and thank you for speaking English so much. I know it's hard, but appreciate it. And I repeat my invitation to please come to Washington if you can. We would love to host you at MITRE. We'll show you our facility, and then also, like I said, we'll go in the U.S. when you skip school to go do something else. It's called playing hooky. It's very slang. So we'll play hooky and we'll go to the museum.